What I love about Nicole, she is a mother who plays, really plays.
What I love about Charlie,
he loves being a dad. He loves all the things you're supposed to hate, like waking up at night.
She knows when to push me and when to leave me alone.
He never lets other people keep him from what he wants to do.
It's not easy for her to close a cabinet.
He's incredibly neat.
She's brave.
He's brilliant.
She's very, very competitive.
It's a movie about marriage as seen through divorce. It's also a movie about family as seen through divorce. I felt like this was also a way to kind of more deliberately explore what happens in real life when couples break up.
You don't think Charlie and Nicole will ever get back together?
No. I think this time it's really over.
Friends take sides or things. And in a way, the audience plays the part of the friends in this movie. So like in the beginning of the movie, you're more with her. And I think naturally, because we're with her, your sympathy goes towards her. So you kind of hear more her angle and her side. And then we kind of move over to him. And then maybe you would actually start to sympathize with him too.
Noah does a good job playing with the allegiance of audience, where you feel like you have a good sense of like who you're supposed to be following, and then suddenly that shifts and you look at somebody a different way. I feel like that's very true to life.
I felt it was a kind of cinematic way or narrative way to illustrate when people break up, which is nobody's fault. It's just something that didn't work out.
Anytime anyone asked me about what I was working on, I'm like, I'm working on a movie with Noah, and it's the best thing he's ever written.
When I started writing, I felt like it would be helpful to know who the couple was. I'd already been talking to Adam Driver about what it could be and what his job could be. And having those discussions, of course, we knew it was a two-hander and, you know, who was going to be his partner in this, and we both loved the idea of Scarlett.
I think he'd been developing the idea for some years, and it was starting to become more clear.
It was, I think, invaluable for me in writing it, having their voices, their physicality in my head.
You know, we had to sort of commit to each other.
They were both so open and, you know, generous in talking even just about their lives and things that might be applicable to the story at large, not even necessarily just their characters.
I really like how human these people were. It's such an obvious thing to say about a script, but they just seemed so fallible and very vulnerable.
See them on the subways, sort of apart from each other. We know things are somewhat tense. And what I'm interested in is how the other characters, or, you know, maybe supporting characters or incidental characters, aren't in on that. You know, the babysitter's living her own life. She's not in on that story.
God, you guys are so attractive. Sorry, I didn't stop that from being said.
It's my job, in a way, to honor that real environment.
It's such a life-changing event, getting divorced. You know, you think your life is going to be one thing, and then it's suddenly not. And while you have the gain of all these possibilities in your life, you have a huge sense of loss.
If you don't like that mediator, we'll find another one.
Yeah.
We might not need a mediator. We'll just split everything anyway. I don't care.
Me neither.
You can have most of it. We'll get apartments near each other, make it easier for Henry. We'll figure it out. We want the same thing.
Right.
Meantime, the pilot will be fun for you.
You don't think it's bad, do you?
I don't ever watch TV, so, you know, I can't tell. Noah had a great way of combining ideas that we had talked about so seamlessly into his characters that was so impressive to me.
Nice. What? Are you kidding me? I was just in jail.
In the beginning of the film, she's hit some version of like an emotional rock bottom and realizes that she needs something more, I think, to survive.
I'm gonna give you a number.
Okay, is it a therapist? Because I have a therapist. Well, it's my mom's therapist. We share her.
She's a lawyer. She represented me when I left Dennis.
Oh, you and Dennis are divorced?
Since 2013.
And sometimes that's really where the truth of stuff lies, is in those uncomfortable places.
Nora got me half of this project in the settlement.
Oh, well, we talked about doing it without lawyers. And my sister had me meet a bunch of them already, and I just hated them.
Call Nora. She saved my life.
On one hand, it's a human extremely emotional experience for the people going through it, but then also you suddenly have to get lawyers and involve all these strangers in your life.
Sorry, I look so schleppy. I had an event at my kid's school.
Let me get this out of the way. I think you're a wonderful actress.
Thank you.
I loved All Over the Girl, but the theater stuff, too.
You saw the theater stuff?
I was in New York last year for my book, which reminded me to give you a copy.
Laura is such a wonderfully open person. She's so warm and inviting and feels like a safe place, which is exactly what the character needs.
You're saying I want something better for myself.
You do.
And this right now is the worst time. It will only get better.
Wasn't it Tom Petty who said the waiting is the hardest part? I represented his wife in their divorce. I got her half of that song.
Oh, I don't want any money or anything.
That line of dialogue says so much to me about a character, and it sometimes a line of dialogue will help me write a scene, which will then reveal the characters to me, which then reveals the movie to me.
Noah and I have been talking for a long time about this project, about the irony of certain marital situations or the experience of having a kid and all of these intricacies that became part of this film.
So Cassie, when Charlie gets here, you're gonna hand him the envelope.
Why do I have to do it?
Because Nicole is very good at getting people to do things for her.
That's not what this is.
I wiped her butt till she was 9 years old. She's very seductive that way.
No, Mom, legally, I can't be the one who serves him.
But still, what I'm saying is true.
Do I have to actually hand him the envelope?
Yes, but I'm gonna tell him in advance that they're divorce papers.
I love those screwball comedies, those 30s and 40s comedies. Screwball comedy, we often think of all the overlapping dialogue and the sort of chaotic quality of them, people going in and out of rooms. So you get all the sort of family dynamics going, and that seemed inherently humorous to me.
We love Charlie.
You have to stop loving him, Mom. You can't be friends with him anymore.
G-Mom!
Charlie Bird!
Mom? Mom!
What? That was so brilliant at finding the comedy in the middle of something so excruciating.
What's this?
It's a manila envelope, love.
Ooh, can I start over?
It has my name on it.
Ooh. Oh, Jesus. Sorry. You're served.
What did you do?
Nothing. I don't know. I can't lie. You're being served. You guys are getting a I don't know. I'm sorry.
The absurdity of having to serve your spouse. It's also horrible. And then the scene kind of transforms. I mean, from Charlie's perspective, really the horror of what's going on.
What do I do?
You get a lawyer too.
Ultimately, I thought it was important with the lawyers that they be people you recognize, like Alan, who doesn't love him, you know?
I wouldn't expect too much from that cat.
And then if Ray Liotta was brought in as your lawyer, you'd be like, how can we negotiate with this guy?
Here's the fact, Jack. I charge $950 an hour. Ted is $400. If you have a stupid question, you call Ted.
This was just written so well. It's nice to see something very character-driven.
If we start from a place of reasonable and they start from a place of crazy, when we settle, we'll be somewhere between reasonable and crazy.
Which is still crazy.
Half of crazy is crazy.
What Noah does is wonderfully right on the knife edge. To some extent, it's happening to somebody else, but to some extent, it's happening to you because you identify with the characters.
I want you to know that eventually this will all be over. And whatever we win or lose, it'll be the two of you having to figure this out together.
Thank you. First person in this process has spoken to me like a human.
The beauty of the story that Noah's telling is that if you can't sympathize with what the other side must be going through, you'll forever be lost.
Stuart rose from the ditch, climbed into his car, and started up the road that led toward the north. The sun was just coming up over the hills on his right. As he peered ahead into the great land that stretched before him, the way seemed long, but the sky was bright, and he somehow felt he was headed in the right direction.
forgot it ended that way.
That was sort of the challenge in the writing, I think, was that it's a foregone conclusion that these people aren't going to get back together, but they have to stay together because they share a child.
You're going to go with your daddy, and it's going to be fun. And I got a present for you when you get back as a reward.
It's not going to the dentist.
I'm trying to help.
I'm staying here.
Come on. Henry?
You see it in thrillers all the time. All the stuff that seemed innocent in the beginning, you know, he touched the wine glass, we have the fingerprint, you know, what all those things that suddenly become part of the police investigation. I thought in a funny way, that's also what happens in a divorce. Things that are just part of your day-to-day life as a couple, as a family, when presented as an argument by a lawyer, suddenly take on a different meaning.
On a recent visit to Los Angeles, the car seat, which he had assured Nicole had been professionally installed, was clearly not even belted in. It was just sitting in the back seat.
You have to buckle in the car seat. It's the law.
Whoop. Sorry, I drank too much wine.
And Nora, I don't think you'll be too happy if I ask Nicole about her alcohol consumption in the evenings.
What?
She confided in Charlie one night recently, having just carried Henry to bed, that she was having trouble standing while walking down the staircase.
I've never had so much fun talking about a character and playing out thoughts and fantasies in our minds of all the places it could go.
New York and Los Angeles are both representative of different notions of home and where is home.
Please take the ticket.
Dad, you're too far.
I know.
Please take the ticket.
Plays on familiarity and how familiar places can suddenly feel unfamiliar.
So I'm not comfortable leaving the bags in the car where I've given the key to someone I don't really know.
The direction is invisible. It's very discreet. Noah never drawing attention to himself. Everything is in service of the characters, the story, the drama. It's a style that brings Mike Nichols and Elia Kazan to mind, and the aesthetic is so clearly reflective of a singular vision.
He's just totally limitless, the way that he can see something, a scene, the possibility.
Tomorrow this woman is going to come and visit us and be with us while we eat dinner.
Both Charlie and Nicole have that challenge, which is to create a sense of normalcy for the evaluator and to sort of not bring Henry into it.
Sure, I can't get you anything?
No, I'm fine, thank you.
Do the thing with the knife.
No, I'm not. No.
Come on.
It's not a dinner thing. It's not an anytime thing.
What's the thing with the knife?
It's the most challenging situation to be a parent, and you know, he does his best.
The knife thing is, I carry this knife on my keychain, which his mother got me, actually. And I do this thing for his mom where I pretend to cut myself, but I retract the blade. But I don't do it with him. Oh. That's fine.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I must not have retracted the blade all the way.
Do you need...
Yeah. No, it's fine. What else can I tell you?
My favorite part of writing is when I feel inside a story and I do feel like the scenes are just kind of alive to me, and then I'm having ideas and the ideas are giving me ideas. It's the most fun. I wanted a big, warm, romantic score for the movie.
The picture begins with a 7-minute montage. Noah wanted the sound not to be necessarily conventional. It introduces themes and such that use throughout the picture and is an introduction of each principal characters.
Almost like the movie's reaction to what was going on. And often, it was reacting with compassion. The opening of the movie was quite daunting because that music is playing their marriage. You know, it's what I love about Charlie, what I love about Nicole.
I opened up with a French horn for him. And just in passing, the music's going, it'll notice it, and there'll be a little grace on it.
Can you lower the board, please, Pablo?
Here? How about here? How about now?
Why is there always a flirty grip?
Her was a kind of a piano-oriented thing, because she was walking.
Once he worked on that, it really gave us a foundation for the rest of the movie, because the music, in a sense, doesn't change. It's almost like it keeps playing variations on the love story, even though it's the story of a breakup. In addition to being an incredible singer-songwriter and lyricist and writer of film melodies, he's an incredible orchestrator, too, and he conducts. He's one of a kind. I mean, he knows so much about music and what music is capable of, you know, what music can do and what it can't do for a movie.
Mom!
Is if something's exciting, it can make it more exciting. Sad, more sad. You don't want to get noticed, necessarily. But it can add a great deal to a picture.
You take some breaths. And while you do, I'm going to tell you about myself.
Scarlett's first meeting with Laura Dern's character, I almost wanted it to feel like a seduction.
Can you tell me a little more about what's going on? Because part of what we're going to do together is tell your story.
It's like meeting the right person at the right time, and there's something so open and smart about Laura. This isn't your friend, really, but for that moment, she is her friend.
It's a very odd relationship between the divorce lawyer and her client, because you come, as does Nicole, with your heart cracked open, looking for guidance.
Oh, this tea is delicious.
Isn't it? It's the Manuka honey. Mm. Nora probably considers herself someone who does it with great etiquette, but regardless, she's a bully.
Charlie, is this like the deal that you made, that you and Nicole would spend more time in L.A. during your marriage?
We didn't have a deal. It was something we discussed, but...
So it's a deal when it's something you want and a discussion when Nicole wants it?
Sidebar.
Laura goes toe-to-toe with Ray Liotta. I wanted really formidable people representing this formidable couple.
I don't see how you can claim that she gets half a grand dedicated to his genius.
He became a genius during the course of the marriage.
She comes with her guns loaded. She really does. It was great.
I loved your play.
Oh, thanks.
Really? You are one smart cookie.
Thanks.
I would just love to crawl inside that brain. There was that one moment when you smell the toast. Smell. It was literally my favorite thing that I saw that year.
Oh, thanks.
Truly, genius.
Thank you.
I was sorry to hear it closed on Broadway.
They couldn't smell the toast.
Laura was so important. She was just a great sounding board.
To read this one particular monologue that Noah wrote for my character, it was like Christmas morning. Let's face it, the idea of a good father was only invented like 30 years ago. Before that, fathers were expected to be silent and absent and unreliable and selfish. And we can all say we want them to be different. But on some basic level, we accept them. We love them for their fallibilities, but people absolutely don't accept those same failings in mothers. We don't accept it structurally, and we don't accept it spiritually, because the basis of our Judeo-Christian whatever is Mary, mother of Jesus, and she's perfect. She's a virgin who gives birth, unwaveringly supports her child and holds his dead body when he's gone. And the dad isn't there. It's outrageous, because it so speaks to how we consider mothers. God is the father, and God didn't show up.
That's just great writing, you know.
There's a point with all good actors where they know more about some aspects of the character than you do.
Scarlett has like a rare ability to be very strong and very vulnerable and to undulate between the two, being completely relaxed and completely in control, that it's a really impressive thing to watch.
It was amazing. I mean, it was, you know, quite a monologue for Scarlett to tackle.
And I thought, well, wouldn't it be great to have a long monologue in a movie that you don't see coming, so that it's only about midway in you realize this is still happening?
This pilot came along, it shot in LA, and it paid so much, and it was like there was this little lifeline thrown to me. Here's this bit of earth that's yours. And I was embarrassed about it in front of him, but it was also like, yeah, this is who I am, and this is what I'm worth. And maybe it's stupid, but at least it's mine. And if he had just taken me into a big hug and said, baby, I'm so excited for your adventure. Of course I want you to have a piece of earth that's yours. And, well, then we might not be getting divorced.
A woman I interviewed who'd been through a divorce said that it takes momentum to leave. I felt in a way that this was a way to sort of almost present momentum almost in its essence, you know, that she's building it up as she's telling the story.
Then he realized about the money, and he told me I could funnel it back into the theater company. And that's when I realized he truly didn't see me. He didn't see me as something separate from himself. And I asked him to say my phone number. He didn't know it. So I left. Also, I think he slept with the stage manager, Marianne. This was a huge turning point for her. It's like her life before and after Nora's office, you know? I'd be so upset if another actor had that scene before me.
If there's someone that you have to do this really hard thing with, there's not a lot of people that you'd really like want to do that with, but Scarlett is for sure like one of them. You want to go into battle with this person.
That'd be nice for him. I'll have two Halloweens.
What am I going to do with him for second Halloween? Walk around Sunset Boulevard?
Maybe the hotel has something. Or you can drive to a different neighborhood.
I would divorce her all over again.
Hello?
Are you moving out here?
Did you find a lawyer?
Yes. Henry says you're moving here?
Have your lawyer call Nora.
It's such a push and pull between these two characters. You know, they have an intimacy that's familiar, but now it's uncomfortable.
That's what we always said we do. It's not up to them. It's up to us. It's our divorce.
They say I could later sue them for malpractice.
What am I walking into?
Adam is such an incredible actor, and I so hugely admire him, and I love working with him so much because I feel very connected to him.
I want a MacArthur Grant.
Charlie! Oh my God, that's great!
What I love about acting with him is you're talking to a real person. When you talk to a real person, you see a change in their face as you speak to them. They respond, they're there, and that's what Adam does. He's like a real person. He is the guy.
Listen, if I were representing you...
You are representing me.
Right, no, of course, no. I don't see a judge moving this child from California. I think we try and settle today.
Settle meaning what?
She gets L.A.
No, Bert, just no. I mean, we have to win this.
So you don't have to act at him. You just toss the ball to him. He tosses it back.
Do not compare me to my father.
I didn't compare you to him. I said you were acting like him.
You're exactly like your mother. Everything you're complaining about her, you're doing. You're suffocating Henry.
First of all, I love my mother. She was a wonderful mother.
Just repeating what you told me.
Secondly, how dare you compare my mothering to my mother? I may be like my father, but I am not like my mother.
You are! And you're like my father. You're also like my mother. You're all the bad things about all of these people.
There were many great things about him as an actor. And then beyond that, you know, he had such confidence in what he's doing.
But you and I both know you chose this life. You wanted it until you didn't. You used me so you could get out of LA.
I didn't use you.
You did, and then you blamed me for it. You always made me aware of what I was doing wrong, how I was falling short. Life with you was joyless.
He's so good that you can kind of keep pressing down on these things and getting more out of him.
Every day I wake up and I hope you're dead. Dead like if I could guarantee Henry would be okay. I'd hope you'd get an illness and then get hit by a car and die. I'm sorry.
Me too.
That was something we always talked about, is that love is always present in every scene, no matter how contentious things get. It's something that both Adam and Scarlett just convey, you know, they just, it's just inside, it's inside them.
You read it now.
He's very competitive. He loves being a dad. He loves all the things you're supposed to hate, like the tantrums, the waking up at night. It's almost annoying how much he likes it, but then it's mostly nice. He disappears into his own world. He and Henry are alike that way. He can tell people they have food in their teeth or on their face in a way that doesn't make them feel bad.
Because of how beautiful a script it is, at its core, it's a reminder and a teacher to the essential nature of sympathizing.
He could remember all the inside jokes. He's extremely organized and thorough. He's very clear about what he wants, unlike me, who can't always tell. I fell in love with him 2 seconds after I saw him.
It's an example of the really wonderful writing of the whole movie, is that you face reality in ways that are surprising and that turn out to be kind of funny.
I'm forever inspired by Noah's ideas. He's just incredible.
I feel like he makes movies that they're kind of meant to be watched again and again and again.
If any of us have gone through the intimacies of divorce and with children, it's, you know, one's own experience of it.
In a way, I saw it as a love story, but like loving the person you're no longer in love with. You know, you have to find new ways to love this person.